This is a six-cylinder rotary Stirling engine, which looks and sounds like a Gatling gun. This is a heat shield. Its job is to keep the fire from heating any more than just the end of the tube. And then this is a fan. These tabs push air and blow it across these cylinders to keep them cool for a bit longer, so the engine will run for a bit longer. When you hear this clicking, what is happening is as that piston goes up and down, it's working against the displacer and causing them to go back and forth. As the piston goes towards the crankshaft, it's sucking on that displacer. When the piston comes up, it's blowing against the displacer. And that's what you're hearing, is all those displacers going back and forth just because of the action of the piston. Disconnecting all the tubes, when I spin the engine, the displacers make no noise at all. If I connect one cylinder, when I spin the engine, that one displacer is making noise. So that verifies the fact that the piston going up and down does work against that displacer. This is the hot end assembly. There's six displacer tubes, one for each cylinder of the engine. As you turn this back and forth, you can hear those displacers slide back and forth. I've heard it said that these contain balls, but they do not contain a ball. It is a cylinder, and it's being guided by a tube. This part is pressed into this aluminum plate, and that's that outside ring. And this inside part is a tube, and it's pressed in there, and it extends up in here. If I hold this vertically and push this rod in through this tube, I can lift that displacer up and down. I don't want to do that very often because I'm not really sure what that displacer is made of. It could be glass. This tube is open on the end and connects to the area that's inside the displacer. The silicone tubes connect to the area that's external to the displacer. So the displacer is not a piston. It travels back and forth, and there is some airflow on either side of the displacer. The job of the displacer is to help direct the hot air to the piston and then cooler air back to the hot end to be reheated. And so that displacer is going back and forth all the time. And there's a very fine line between where the hot air stops and the cool air starts. And after this runs for a while, the cylinder does get heated. There is some hot air that works its way up here to the cylinder. When the piston is at the top of its travel and the displacer has moved all the way to this end of the displacer cylinder, the air in here is passing over the flame. It gets hot, it expands, and it's moving in this direction. At that point in time, the pressure here is slightly higher than the pressure at the piston. And that slight differential pressure helps move this displacer in this direction, and the hot air is traveling and pushes on top of the piston. The piston pushes through the connecting rod to the crankshaft and causes the engine to rotate. When the piston gets to the bottom of its travel, it starts upwards, and that's pushing air back in this direction through this tube. And the power of the piston is from the momentum of the spinning engine. And at that point in time, the pressure here is a little bit higher than the pressure here, and the displacer is moving in this direction and helps distribute slightly cooler air back to this point to be reheated. And each cylinder in turn, that process just repeats itself and the engine keeps running. This is a rotary engine, not a radial. In a rotary engine, the crankshaft is fixed and the crankcase and cylinders rotate about the crankshaft. The piston is at top dead center. The displacer tube or cylinder is over the fire. The air is heated, it expands, and is creating a little higher pressure than what's on top of the piston. The displacer starts moving in this direction. The pressure is pushing against the piston, acting against the crankshaft, and the engine is caused to rotate. Now that the piston is at bottom dead center, as it rotates, the piston's moving upward. It starts compressing the air on top of the piston, creating a higher pressure here than what's in the displacer cylinder. The displacer is moving to the rear. And by the time we get here, the displacer has traveled all the way back. The cylinder is back over the fire. And the whole process repeats itself. This is a Ringbom Stirling engine. That means that the displacer in here has no mechanical connection to the engine. It free floats back and forth and is driven by differential pressure. Take the top off of this cylinder gently. And inside is a glass tube with a silicone O-ring. Each cylinder has an aluminum piston and it has a glass tube on the outside of it, which we can see here. The inner glass tube, which is attached to the aluminum piston, slides up and down inside this outer glass tube. This is a very fine thread. You need to be careful you don't get them crossed, and that this piece doesn't catch on the edge of that glass tube. Continue to crank that down until it bottoms out and tightens against that silicone O-ring. There are six magnets in here, and the holes are cut into this aluminum ring, and this ring is just a mounting plate and holds the axle for the cylinders. And then this end of the Gatling gun has six more magnets in it, and it's just magnetic coupling that will actually spin independent of this piece. And just for fun, I'm going to try and fire this up without that Gatling gun attached to it. I'm going to put this on this piece of board just to give it a little more stability. This tends to be a little bit tail heavy without that gun hanging out here. Generally, if you let this preheat for a minute, it's ready to go, and it doesn't care which way it runs. The magnetic drive puts a little bit of load on the engine. You can just stop that barrel, and sometimes it'll slowly turn in the opposite direction. This is turning clockwise, and this wants to turn slowly counterclockwise. You see, now it's trying to turn in the opposite direction real slow. This is quite a large engine when you see it alongside of the vertical hit and miss or the vacuum engine. It's not as heavy as the vacuum engine, but it is fairly heavy.